Greetings to everyone. In today's video, you will see a teardown of Denon DCD1550AR CD player. This model has been in production from 1999 until 2003. You can find a full list of technical specifications in the description below. And in meantime, I will focus on what's inside of this beautiful player. Just before I start, I'd like to remind you that your likes and subscriptions are much appreciated. You also can follow me on Instagram to know on what video I'm working at this moment. And if you enjoy watching my videos and find them useful, please consider supporting this channel on Patreon. Great, so let's crack on and see what's inside of Denon DCD1550AR. Before I power down this player, I have to open the tray and remove the front fascia. If I don't do it now, I won't be able to remove the front panel later. Now I can remove the top cover. It is fixed with two screws from the right-hand side, two from the rear, another two from the left, and four more from the top. Top cover feels quite thick and heavy. Inside of this player looks very neat. Layout of DCD1550AR is quite typical for a CD player, with power supply board on the right, transformer nearby, and a CD mechanism located right in the middle of the unit. Audio and variable volume PCBs are located on the right, with servo PCB sitting under. My next step would be removing the rear panel, which is fixed with two screws to the top of the chassis and with three more screws to the bottom. After six screws, which are securing all the sockets on the rear panel, are undone, the panel itself can be removed. In order to clear more room and to make extraction of the other components a little bit easier, I will remove the front panel next. First of all, I will disconnect the cable which links the power switch with PSU PCB. Next goes the ribbon cable linking the servo and display PCBs. To protect the display PCB, I will insulate the end of the ribbon cable with some electrical tape. The last cable that is still connected is the one which links headphones and audio PCBs. Great, now I only have to undo three screws which are securing front panel to the bottom of the chassis and two more which are securing it to the top. After this procedure is finished, front panel can be removed. Alright, let's take a closer look at the front panel. To extract the display PCB, I have to remove the jog dial knob and undo the nut which secures it to the front panel. As six screws are undone and headphones cable is untangled, display PCB can be extracted. On this PCB we can find a remote sensor, the display itself, bunch of micro switches and one rotary encoder. There are no active components here, as all the control functions of this unit are implemented by servo PCB. Now it is time to remove the power switch PCB, which is fixed with two screws to the inner side of the front panel. Very simple PCB with only two components, the capacitor and the switch. I wanted to remove the buttons and give them a good clean, as I always do when I'm tearing down the old units, but it looks like these buttons are glued in and cannot be removed. This is not a problem. I will carry on and remove the headphones volume control knob. And now, when it is done, I can undo three screws to remove the headphones PCB. Can't tell anything exciting about this PCB either. But what really excites me is the quality of the front panel, which is made of solid piece of brushed aluminium. Even the little fascia at the end of the tray is also made of aluminium. Great! Now when front panel and the rear panels are removed, it is time to dig even deeper and extract the power PCB together with the transformer. As always, all the cables have to be disconnected before I start unscrewing the PCB itself. First goes the power switch and transformer cables. Then the cables which are feeding server and audio PCBs. And the last two are the transformer outputs. Now it is time to undo four screws and extract the power PCB. This PCB provides a whole variety of different voltages to this unit. I will put a full pinout on the screen for you to have a more of a detailed look. Alright, let's untangle all these wires and extract the transformer. As you can see, the CD mechanism and the transformer are fixed to this bracket, which adds more rigidness to this unit. Here we go, that's the transformer extracted. This transformer has one primary and four secondary windings. Next, I'm going to extract the variable PCB. I have just discovered something very curious. The thing is that the audio signal for the right channel is included in this bigger connector, and the signal for the left channel is coming through the smaller 3-pin connector. Quite an unusual solution, I would say. Next, I have to desolder the ground bus cable, as it's the only way to separate variable and audio PCBs. Great, two screws are undone and variable PCB is extracted. Alright, let's take a closer look at this PCB. The main component on this board is this Panasonic 2-channel CMOS electronic volume control chip. It allows you to adjust the level of output with remote control. It is not the most useful feature of this player, in my opinion. Before the audio signal gets into the electronic volume control chip, it is amplified by these ultra low noise wideband dual operational amplifiers made by NEC. These are dual op amps, which means that there is one more amplification circuit for each channel, which is used to boost the audio signal after it comes out from electronic volume control chip. My next step would be to extract the audio PCB, which is fixed with two screws and two plastic clips. But before I undo the plastic clips, I must not forget to disconnect the ribbon cable, which links audio and server PCBs. I will protect the end of the ribbon cable with some electrical tape, of course. Now, using my long nose pliers, I can undo the clips and extract the audio PCB. Great, let's have a look at the audio PCB. One tiny detail that drew my attention was that the audio PCB was protected from the bottom by this black plastic sheet. It's a minor detail, but things like this is what makes it a higher grade product. Now let's talk about the components most of you are interested in. These are PCM61P serial input 18-bit monolithic audio digital to analog converters made by Burr Brown Corporation. By the way, Burr Brown Corporation was acquired by Texas Instruments in September 2000. That means that this is one of the last CD players equipped with Burr Brown DACs. I will leave the link in the description if someone would like to familiarize themselves with full list of technical specifications. On this board we can also see a pair of OP275 dual bipolar JFET audio operational amplifiers made by Analog Devices. One more operational amplifier is present on this board. C4570C is exactly the same operational amplifier as those that we saw earlier on variable PCB. However, this one is used to amplify the audio signal dedicated for headphones. Connector that links audio and headphones PCB is located nearby. As I've mentioned earlier, these are the links that provide an audio signal for the variable PCB. And of course, the main RCA outputs. Let's move on and extract the servo PCB. I will disconnect all the cables first, starting with the cable that provides power for this board. This one is the loading motor and the open-close switch. Next one is the spindle motor and a laser slider motor. This one connects with the laser diode as well as focus and tracking coils. Last one is a photo detector. By the way, if you would like to know more about the principles of how the CD player works, I will leave the link in the description to a very useful video. Finally, I can unscrew four screws that are securing the servo PCB. And when it's done, the last PCB is extracted. Okay, let's see what we have here. The thing that stands out most is that there are no chips on the top of this board. All the integrated circuits are located on the flip side of this PCB. It is probably done that way to keep all the digital circuitry as far apart from audio PCB as possible. Talking about integrated circuits, this is a Renesas 8-bit single-chip microcomputer. Some of its functions are controlling the loading motor, displaying the information on the front of the screen, and responding to commands from keyboard and the remote control. This chip, made by Panasonic, is a 3-beam method head amplifier integrated circuit for CD. This is the first chip that meets all the data that was read from the disk. In order to ensure that all the data is read correctly, the laser is focused and it follows pits and lands the way it should, we have this Panasonic 4-channel linear driver IC. This is a signal processing LSI, also made by Panasonic. Its functions are to control focus, tracking and traverse servers, as well as digital signal processing, such as EFM demodulation and error correction. This is where a digital audio signal splits in two streams, one of which is dedicated for optical and coaxial outputs, and the other one travels further towards the audio PCB. But before the audio signal will reach the digital-to-analog converters, it has to pass through the Denon Alpha processor. Sadly, but I couldn't find the datasheet to provide you with more detailed description. And the last thing that I want to point out is this micro switch on the top side of the board. This switch allows you to enter the service mode, where you can adjust such things as focus gain, focus balance and focus offset, as well as tracking gain, tracking balance and tracking offset. Finally, it is time to get the CD mechanism out. I have to undo another four screws to separate it from the chassis. This oval-shaped object in the middle of the bracket is made of rubber, and according to Denon, it is called the base rubber. I saw similar rubber dampers inside the Sony CDP-XP930. By the way, check the teardown video of that Sony player if you haven't seen it yet. This is the CD mechanism, which looks a little bit like a grand piano to me. I will put it aside while taking apart what is left. This is the bracket which is supporting the variable PCB. This big bracket accommodates the CD mechanism and the transformer. Feet are gone and the chassis is completely disassembled. This CD mechanism is not completely enclosed like the one inside of my Marantz UD7007 or other more expensive players, but it feels quite heavy and well made. First, I will remove the clamp holder. It was a bit tricky to lift the clamp holder, and it appears that the clamp itself is magnetic. Next, I will undo three screws to remove the bearing assis and one more screw to release the shaft holder. Now I just have to slide a shaft holder a little bit back and the whole tray can be removed. I was able to remove the shaft and the metal loader bracket, but I was unable to remove the support bracket from the bottom of the tray as they were welded together. My next step would be to separate the laser base from the CD mechanism chassis. To finish this operation, I only have to undo two screws and cut the cable ties, which are securing cables in the right place. Only a few things are still attached to the CD mechanism chassis. These are an open-close switch and loading motor. Three relay gears, UD plate gear, and the loading gear. Now I have to remove remaining cable ties and undo four screws to separate the mechanism base. As you can see, the laser base is suspended on four springs and rubber dampers. Here is the laser base, which includes the spindle motor, slider motor and its gears, and of course the laser head, which by the way is made by Sharp. So that's the Denon DCD1550AR fully disassembled. That's a whole lot of screws which I had to undo to tear this player down. Let's have another look at all electronic components of this unit. And now I will reassemble the unit and show you what is going on inside of it when it operates. Enjoy! Great! This is it for this video. Let me know if you have any questions. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel, follow me on Instagram, or even consider supporting future videos on Patreon. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye!